Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. Thank you for coming to our session. I've just got a couple of housekeeping issues. This session is going to be recorded, and then it'll be available online fairly soon afterwards. Also, if you do take photographs, do not use a flash, please, because it'll affect the filming. Can you hear me all right at the back? Yes? Wonderful. Perfect. Now let's get started. Welcome to our session on Getting to Grips with Action Research for Teachers. I'm Fiona Barker from Cambridge English Language Assessment, and this is Professor Anne Burns from the University of New South Wales in Australia. And we're really pleased to be here today to talk to you about action research. You are going to be doing a few activities later on, so make sure you're sitting next to somebody and don't be afraid to speak to each other later on. This is what we'll cover today. We'll very briefly talk about who our organisations are and our own involvement in action research over the years. Then we'll gather your ideas about what action research is, and then Anne will give you a definition and I'll talk through a model of a particular way of doing action research. We'll then give you two successful projects, two case studies in brief, and then it's up to you. We want to hear your ideas for an action research project in your contexts. And if time, we'll look at a few resources you can use and also what your next steps could be. Over to Anne.
Thanks very much, Fiona. I'm working with an organisation in Australia which is called English Australia. I don't actually work for that organisation. I work at the University of New South Wales, which is in Sydney. However, a few years ago, Cambridge English, very bravely, I think, agreed that they would pilot a programme in Australia where teachers could be involved in doing action research. English Australia, the professional peak body for teachers who teach international students, asked me if I would facilitate that programme. And the English Australia has various strategic goals, which at the time and still today, they were very keen to promote. So those were to influence the whole sector of English language teaching for international students in Australia. Also, to look at the benefits that could accrue from that kind of influence, advocacy and also program development for the sector in the country. And the other thing was to position and grow the program. And as part of that, they saw that teacher education and particularly working professionally with teachers was very important. However, the base of research was not so high in that sector in Australia, and they were known more for perhaps program delivery for international students. So it was quite an adventuresome idea to bring teachers in, to do research with them, and to provide that that pathway, if you like, as a means of professional growth and teacher development for teachers in the country.
Okay, and why is Cambridge English Language Assessment involved? Well, as you probably know, we're a leading provider of language learning and assessment products, all of our exams, courses, teaching qualifications, and so forth. And we're driven by a desire to undertake world-class research. And also, we're thinking about innovation, how we can improve what we do. And we're also moving into digital spheres more and more as time goes on. We're really committed to teacher development, educational excellence. And we're really keen that any language learning that is involved with our exams or teaching qualifications really benefits society. So part of our involvement in the scheme, we provide sponsorship, we provide support as well. And I've been involved in the Australian scheme since around it started 2010. So I get to select teachers' proposals. I also get to meet with some of the teachers. And I also get to review reports and get them published in an online journal. More about that later on. Now, this is up to you. We want your ideas as to what action research is all about. So if you look at your handout, under number one, you've got a couple of questions. So I'd like you to spend 2 minutes talking to your neighbour. What do you already know about action research? How does it work? Have you tried it out? And if so, did you do it by yourself or with others? And we'll stop you in around 2 minutes and bring you back together. Off you go.
OK, Okay. Can we just get a few ideas from around the room? Because this is the kind of process that I would go through with teachers in Australia, just getting their ideas, what they know already about action research. So some ideas that you discussed. What is it? What is it? It's a word that's, it's a term that's used a lot, but what do we know about it? Okay, at the back there.
Action research is something, basically when the teacher do research via action. So teacher actually does the research by observation, by, looking at his pupils directly. So that's okay. Action research.
Thank you. Any more? Yeah.
Yeah. Action research is a psychical process. First, you have to identify a problem, then you devise a plan, and then you observe it, and then at the end you reflect, and then it can go to the next round until you feel to stop.
Okay. And we'll have one more. Somebody had that. Yeah.
I think of it as trying something new in the classroom and seeing how it works. And taking notes about it and reflecting.
Okay. I want to demythologize one thing that I keep hearing about action research. I don't think it has to start with a problem. I'm really strong about this. I keep reading about action research and people talk about problem solving. To me, it's a much richer process. You don't have to start with a problem. You could start with a passion. Something you're really interested in, or something that you're curious about, or something you want to know more about, or something you want to understand better. Please don't think it's about solving problems in the classroom, things that are bad. I think it can be to do with things that you want to reaffirm also. So just that's my little speech about problems in action research. Okay, that's great. So let's have a look a little bit further at how we might characterize action research, if you like. To me, it's very self-reflective. So we're immediately bringing ourselves in as self-reflective practitioners. It's systematic because if it's going to be a research process, you need to have a means of collecting some evidence about the things that you're doing in the classroom. And also, it means being critical in the best possible way, really standing back and looking at what's happening in your classroom, about things you could understand better, things that you can see a little more clearly because you've been going through this systematic process. The other very characteristic thing about action research is that unlike a lot of research where people come in from the outside, are in the classroom for a short period of time, go away, they've researched your classroom and you don't see those people again, you are the daily participants in the action research. So you're very intimately bound up with the daily practices in the classroom and looking at those in a clearer and more critical kind of way. So I'm using the word problematic, but I would never use the word problem. Problematic to me is all those things I mentioned earlier. Do you have a curiosity, a passion, an interest, a dilemma, a puzzle? Any gap or issue that you think is worth pursuing in your classroom that you would really like to take further and know more about? And it's to do with bringing about some sort of changes, but also deeper understanding. So normally we want to improve things if there is an issue, but we also want to understand what's going on, what's happening under the surface of the classroom that perhaps we didn't know so much about before. And for me, one of the reasons I'm passionate about action research myself is that I want to democratize research. I want teachers to have voices in research because I think in ELT we're at a point where we really need to know what the practices are, what the concerns are of teachers in the classroom. It's not so much, I think the plenary speaker this morning referred to the Ferrari version of life. We want to look at what's happening on the ground and in the chalk face, if you like. Okay, so action research is often typically reflected as a sort of cycle. I think this cycle is a little simplistic, okay? I think it's kind of reduces the process a little bit too much for me. However, if you're not used to action research, it's a very useful mind frame, if you like, or a plan, a sort of process that you can think about. So we start with something which is to do with planning, maybe something they're curious about, and then we plan to do it maybe a little bit differently in the classroom. So that's where the action comes in. We might decide to do group work in the classroom differently from the way we've done it before, for example. Then the observation is the systematic part, the part where we really want to collect evidence about what's happening as a result. On your handout, you've got a whole list of ways that evidence can typically be collected in action research. And then reflection. It seems to come in at the end of this cycle, but for me, it permeates the whole cycle. It's pervasive. So I think the reflection starts from the minute you go into the classroom and creatively try out something that's new or different, and look at what's happening as a result of all of that.
Okay, and now I'm going to take you through a model of an action research program. And this is the same model that we use in the English Australia program. We also have a similar program in the UK for UK teachers with English UK. So if you work for an English UK school, you might be able to take part in our scheme next year. So first of all, once proposals are accepted for typically up to around 12 teachers working on projects in pairs or individually, we have an introductory workshop. And this introductory workshop is crucial. The teachers get to meet each other. They also get to discuss their plans, knock them into better shape. They also think about the research design, their research questions, getting consent from participants, and they start to think about what data they're going to collect and how they're going to analyse it. Then the projects take place over a 2 or 3 month period, and they get input from an expert such as Anne Burns or Simon Borg in the UK scheme. And this leads into another workshop where typically teachers have started their first cycle of research and they bring some data to analyse at that workshop. The projects go on for a further 2 or 3 months, at which time maybe a second or third cycle takes place. And more data is collected, more analysis is undertaken. This leads into a final workshop, whereby it's typically a one-day workshop, the others are 2 days, where all the teachers practice presenting their research ahead of presenting at a teachers' conference. There's online communication with the teachers all the way through and tutoring by Anne or Simon via Skype or email or Wiki. We're trying different things out. We haven't yet found the best way of keeping in touch with all the teachers. We're using WhatsApp this year in English UK and that in the English scheme, and that seems to be working quite well. So it takes a place over around 6 or 7 months, so it's a reasonable time commitment. The main point about, I think, action research, it's obviously doing the research in your classrooms, investigating something that means something to you in your context. But the really crucial part is sharing outcomes. It's not just doing a research project and then doing nothing with the results, not talking about it. And in both schemes, all of the teachers get to present, and sometimes it's their first conference presentation, so it's a great CPD opportunity. They also present internally at their language schools or at regional teachers' events. And they also get the opportunity to publish a research article based on it in Research Notes, which is our online journal. There should be copies available on the Cambridge English stand, but we'll give you the link later. They're all freely available online. You might like to think yourselves where these other arrows lead. Maybe it's doing CPD for colleagues in your institution. Maybe it's going on to do a master's program or even a PhD, or other ways of sharing the outcomes of action research. It's definitely important to share it with your colleagues, share it with your peers, share it with your networks. Okay. We've now got 2 case studies.
So. Yes. So just to put a little bit of flesh on what we've been saying about action research, we'd like to introduce you to some of the teachers who've been in our programmes in Australia and in the UK. And this is Brendan. Brendan works at a language college in Western Australia in Perth. He had a mixed nationality class at levels B2, C1, and it was a general English course that he was teaching. He had what was called a rolling enrollment. So students literally rolled into his class every week, and they would stay for maybe between 1 week to 10 weeks. So every week, Brendan had to deal with this new set of people arriving in his classroom, and they had very diverse learning goals. Brendan was really passionately interested in pronunciation. It wasn't a problem for him. It was something that he'd been curious and interested in for a very long time. And he had a kind of a philosophy or a belief about pronunciation from his experience as a language teacher. So he said pronunciation is often neglected, but it makes a huge difference in the confidence and communicative ability and motivation of the students. So this was his perception and belief as a teacher. So to do the action research, he first developed a kind of a question. He focused things down, knew he wanted to work on pronunciation, but how could he focus that into something that was manageable for research? So this was his question. How can students be encouraged to become more aware of the specific aspects of their pronunciation difficulties? He also thought that it wasn't necessarily for him to fix their pronunciation, but students themselves needed to become self-motivated and more autonomous in thinking about their own pronunciation needs. So this was the sort of pathway that he wanted his research to take. So first of all, he explored the students' current awareness. So it was a sort of fact-finding mission, really, to find out what they already thought or knew about their pronunciation, and also whether they had had any previous experience of pronunciation instruction. Well, that wasn't so good, because in fact, none of them had ever had anybody focus specifically on their pronunciation needs in their language instruction, which was not a good situation for them. So then the students themselves did a self-assessment. Brendan gave them a needs analysis chart, looking at different aspects of pronunciation, and asked them to evaluate themselves. He gave them recordings of native speakers and non-native speakers, and he asked them to use the sheet that they'd use for themselves on the pronunciation of the native and non-native speakers. And one of the things that was like a light bulb going off for these students was that you didn't have to be a native speaker. So going back to the presentation again this morning, this was quite a revelation for them. It was good enough to be good enough at speaking English. The students recorded themselves speaking and they analyzed their own difficulties, again using the needs chart, and then they completed quite a few pronunciation activities which Brendan set up in the classroom. As they were coming and going through his class, he had a sort of bank of activities that different students could use, and they recorded themselves again later on and reassessed themselves, and they were absolutely thrilled to notice that they'd made really good improvements. He played the recordings to the group of teachers that we were working with, the before and the after, and it was very, very noticeable that these students had made substantial gains in the way they were speaking English.
Okay, and a second case study, this time from the UK, and Judith Watkins was she received the award for the first year of the English UK scheme in 2014, and she's based at a language college in Northern England, and she was working with a mixed nationality group of intermediate, upper intermediate learners. And again, it was a general English course. And these students were having 18 hours a week over around 12 weeks. Most were intending to study for a master's degree. But her focus was on developing an ERP, an extensive reading program, because she wanted to investigate the effects of implementing this on her students' reading fluency and speed, and also on their attitude to reading in English in general. So her research question is just what I said, really. What would be the effects of an ERP on her students' reading fluency, speed, and on their attitude to reading in English? So this is her methodology. The students essentially completed two questionnaires about their reading habits, one at the start of the action research and one at the end. Students also took a reading speed test to see how quickly they could read. This was based on a graded reader, which I think is quite important. And a control group also only did the timed reading tests as well, just to see if there was any difference between those students that had the intervention and those that didn't. And next, Judith took 30 minutes of class time twice a week to implement the ERP. And she provided graded readers and also journals that were relevant to the students' interests, whether it was dentistry or engineering. And as you saw from the photo on the previous slide, Judith participated, which is really important. So she took some action. She sat down and she read with the students at the same time. And while she was doing that, she was able to make observations of the group. So to see which students were engaging, to see which read sitting up straight and which read sprawled on her desk. Both approaches were fine, by the way. And students had a focus group discussion at the end of both cycles, and they also completed a reading record for every book they completed or every article they completed. And after the five-week cycle, students participated in a group discussion to provide feedback, and there were individual interviews as well. Now, the one significant effect that Judith found was that students claimed to enjoy reading in English far more after undertaking the ERP program over 2 5-week cycles. And if you want to find out more about both projects, do look in research notes online. The references is on your handout. So over to Anne for the last part of our presentation. We want for you to do a little more work now.
Okay, this has been a really rapid run through because we haven't had an awful lot of time, but we would like to get you starting to think about what are the areas that you or issues that you could possibly pick up and look at in your classroom. On the bottom half of your handout are some questions. Talk to your neighbour for a little while and then we'll get a little bit of feedback from you. What's the issue? What's important? How could you go about investigating it? And what could you collect? What could you do, like Brendan and Judith, to collect some evidence about what happens? And some ideas on your handout too. Sorry, we're cutting off short, very interesting discussions, but can we just get an idea around the room of just the areas that you think you would like to look at in your classroom? This is going to be a bit of a buzz, so you're not allowed more than one sentence or even a couple of words, okay, because we're so short of time. Okay, so anybody like to give us an idea of what is it that you would like to pursue as an issue in your classroom? Pronunciation, right. So some ideas from Brendan there. And as Fiona said, you can read the whole article if you'd like to know more. Great.
I'd like to help my students for their writing more lengthy texts.
Lengthy? More lengthy text. Okay, so to write more and to create more lengthy text. Yeah, expand their writing. Excellent idea for action research. There were some more hands. Yeah.
Maybe dealing with students in the large classroom?
Yeah, a large classroom. Yeah, this is a really important area, isn't it? Many teachers have to teach in very large classrooms. What do you do to make that more creative, to make it more effective for the students? That's an excellent area for research. Yeah?
Developing the confidence to write their own work.
Developing confidence to write their own work. Yeah, actually, strangely enough, many of the things that the teachers have researched, and we've given you a couple of examples, have resulted in greater student confidence. Even though the teachers didn't set out to do that, it seems to create better learner autonomy and better confidence. So confidence is a really important aspect of language learning. Very nice topic. There were some more hands that went up. Yeah. Intrinsic motivation. So looking again at what can you do to motivate the students and bring them in perhaps to what you're doing in the classroom. These are excellent suggestions and they'd all create great starting points for action research. We'll have one more maybe. Did you have your hand up? No. Okay. Any other? Yeah.
Creativity in order to foster their creativity, also related to the assessment.
Yeah, creativity linked to assessment. So I was at a session this morning on creativity, and it's something we're really becoming more interested in. How do we foster creativity? And then how do we assess it? What is it that we can do to assess creativity? Well, just one more. Yeah.
I have a large number of students in my class, 12 like that.
but they're really reluctant to even produce very everyday common expression.
Okay. You've had three sentences now. Sorry. Sorry. So large classes and getting ways of students being able to produce the language in such a situation where it's so difficult with many students in the classroom. Thank you so much. They're brilliant ideas. I just hope that you go away from today and do some action research, and the handout will give you some ideas. Yeah. Oh, there are. Yeah, just point out the articles are free in the Cambridge English site. Go to that. There's a video that I made quite a long time ago, which more or less covers more of what we've been talking about. There's some references to some key readings as well. So, Fiona, did you want to just...
That's it, no. I think we've covered everything.
Please.
Thank you.